Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another episode on Entrepreneurship. So today we have Amishi joining in. So thank you very much for being here. It's my pleasure to have you.
Hi, Lakshit. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you so much for having me on your podcast.
Yeah, thank you very much for joining again. So yeah, for the first question, if you can speak about yourself and what you do.
Sure. So basically, I run a company called Upcyclers Lab. And what we do through Upcyclers Lab is we try and create play-based learning tools for young children between the ages of 2 and 9. And all of the tools are based on the environment. So we make products like board games, puzzles, storybooks, etc. on different environmental concepts like waste segregation, ocean conservation. And the entire goal or the vision of the company is to change mindset and behavior around the environment, which is why we work with children so early, because most behavior in humans is developed by the age of 9,
yeah.
After which it's very difficult to develop behavior. And this is why we kind of work in very early education.
Oh, wonderful. So what background do you come from? What's your background? What are the study, your qualifications and studies? Just for simple knowledge.
I come from a very different background. I studied finance, like financial markets, my undergrad. I worked in a financial services company. Then I went abroad to pursue my master's in international business.
Okay.
And while I was there, actually, while I was in the UK pursuing my master's, I was introduced to the concept of social enterprise and upcycling for the first time.
Okay.
And that's when, I kind of realized how big the problem was, and how also through social enterprise, you could make money and make profit, but for good. Because in India, typically people either think you're a completely profit hungry capitalist, company, or you're an NGO that can't really get much stuff done. The pace is slow, the vibe is very different. So there's no in between. And that's kind of what I was excited to build, because I wanted to show other entrepreneurs that it's possible to build a business that does good at its very core, not something that they do as CSR or not something that they do over and above their activities, but at its very core.
Okay.
So that was very exciting for me. And that was my background. But when I came back, I continued to get, I got a job and I continued to have a different career.
Mm-hmm.
But on the weekends, I would upcycle. And after a point, I realized that, it's possible to do this in India and the demand for this product does exist. So I actually quit my job to pursue this full time.
Okay.
Because I said, if I don't do it now, I don't think I'll ever do it. So
yeah.
I quit and I started full time. But my first company was mainly on products for adults. So we made products out of waste for adults. So we made home decor products, furniture, that kind of stuff. And the whole idea over there as well was to make a beautifully designed product out of waste, which would help spark conversations around waste. But of course, that didn't happen, because adults, being adults, they feel like, okay, we've done enough just by buying a product that's made out of waste. There's nothing more to do. So that whole idea of us wanting to change the mindset and behavior wasn't happening. And that's when we kind of reevaluated and really thought about what we wanted. And I decided to start Upcyclers Lab with my co-founder, Manav.
Wonderful. And was it the reason just to, make people more conscious about the environment and the climate change? Or was it, even to a different aspect? Or what was the clear idea and the motto behind starting the company?
Sure. So awareness is a very broad and a very basic term, I would say, because everyone's aware, right? You are aware of why climate change happens. Today's janta is very woke. You don't have to make them aware, because they can get any information. That I don't think awareness is something that's needed today, because I think for the most part, people are aware of what they're doing wrong, of what's needed. But the problem is the behavior change, right? So today, segregation is good. Waste segregation is good. It's important. You'll want to teach it to your children. But do you do it at home? For most of the people, the answer is no. Why? There are 10,000 reasons why. Time nahi hai. Job ke pehle kaun karega? Staff ko kaun sikhayega? So there's 5,000 reasons. So you're aware, but the behavior hasn't changed. So we work in behavior change. And this is why we work with young kids, because we've seen that kids, of course, change their own behavior. They have more time. They have more bandwidth. They are not naive. They're not naive is not the right word. They're not, I would say, judgmental. they come already with like, haan, sab achha hoga. They come with this optimism that everything can happen, you know, well. And they take the action also. Like if you tell them ye karna hai, you know, they implement it in their houses is what we've seen. Not only do they implement it, they convince their parents, they convince their elder siblings, they convince their staff. And usually, bachcho ko koi na nahi bolta. Like no one says no to, you know, their kids. Like if your kid came and told you today, this is, you know, bad, why are you doing this? You're way more likely to listen to it than if another adult comes and tells you. So this is why we kind of wanted to be in the space for behavior change.
Okay. And what kind of things really you do at, you know, Upcycles Lab? What's the, like, how does it work? What are the things you do and what kind of things you teach to learn children? And what are the activities you do over there?
So we basically make the products. When we started, we tried to experiment a little bit with workshops as well. But, you know, what we realized was that it's very, very difficult to scale. And one thing we were very clear on is that we wanted to impact as many people as possible in a short span of time. Because if 10 people or 20 people do zero waste perfectly, it's not going to help as much as 10 million people doing it imperfectly, right? So we were very clear on the fact that we wanted to make big impact. And the way we thought that that was scalable and where our interests were also and where our capabilities were also as an organization was to make products. So what we essentially do is we make play-based products. The reason we make play-based products is because most retention in early education happens through play. So if you remember as well, you will remember your nursery rhymes, your stories very clearly, right? You'll remember instances during your play very clearly, but you may not remember, you know, a theorem that you learned in math class or something that was very, very theoretical, right? You may not remember the dates of like the Panipat war or whatever. So this is why we wanted to pursue play-based learning and go in this direction. And what we right now do is we tie up with large organizations that purchase our products and implement them in their behavior change initiatives. So we started again, when we first launched, we started selling to schools here. We started selling to educational organizations, Bangalore Zoo. We sold individually to parents as well. But again, we realized that it's slow and it's very difficult to scale. So while we still do that, because we still want an individual parent to have access to the product, our main revenue comes from partnering with large organizations. So for example, we've partnered with an organization in Kuwait where our products are implemented as a part of the Green Schools program there. So they piloted the project and now hopefully we'll be expanding to all the schools in Kuwait by the end of this year, early next year, which means that, you know, just with one project, they purchase our products, but we're able to impact millions of children over the next 3 to 5 years in Kuwait. And this is totally going to be government-led, right? So the government kind of drives the project, which means that we know for a fact that the product is going to be compulsory in schools and the teachers are going to create lesson plans around it. So it's not just like, okay, board game khelia, that's enough. This is a great conversational starter. It's a great first tool. It's a way for the teacher to break the ice in a way that's memorable. So they take the product, they start with it with the child. And once the child actually plays it and gets excited about that topic, the teacher starts to introduce more of the technical knowledge involved around it and more of the actions that they can take. So that's what we've done in Kuwait. In Singapore as well, we've partnered with a recycling organization, a very big recycling organization that has won the tender for recycling a large part of Singapore's waste. Now, in Singapore as well, what they do is they use our products in all of the schools in that district where they're going to recycle the waste. And they see, like, they will essentially monitor that what is the quality of waste that is coming segregated. Is that better or worse? If it's better, it means them as a recycling organization also profit more. The waste is more efficiently recycled. There are lesser carbon emissions and less behavior change. So they use our product as a part of this larger project. And again, they build content around it. So ours, we're not saying that ours is a standalone product and you'll use it and you'll overnight become, you'll know everything about it or overnight you'll change your behavior. But ours is the nudge. So when you talk about behavior change or play-based theory, the nudge is also really important. Like what is the first point? What's the introduction? That's what our product does. So that's essentially what we do with our products.
how does the business model work at Upcyclers Lab? If you can, you know, speak about the business model and what are the kind of things involved in it.
Sure. Our business model is very simple. We make products, we design them, we make them, and then we sell them. So, like I said, we have several channels through which we sell. We sell B2B. Within B2B, we sell to distributors as well, toy and game distributors who can put our product in retail markets. Not in India so much, more internationally. And same way in B2B, we also work with these large partner organizations that are in the space of recycling, that are in the space of conservation, that are in the space of ocean conservation cleanups, or even waste segregation and stuff like that. So they buy our products. And then we have B2C, in which we have moms purchase our products. We have schools who want to do smaller orders purchase our products. That's basically been the revenue streams for us so far.
Okay. And how many years have you been in the market, you know, making, you know, as you said, things for teaching and educating and making aware people. So how many years have you been in the market, Upcyclers Lab has been in the market?
So far, we've been in the market for 2 years. We launched in 2018.
Okay.
And we're now in 2020. So it's only been 2 years for us.
Okay. And like what, as coming to the entrepreneur side of the thing, how has been the journey for you, you know, as an entrepreneur? How has been the startup which you started, how it has been, what have you learned by this journey, what have been the dark times for you, you know?
So it's definitely a very tough road, especially being an environmental entrepreneur in a country like India, where it's not still so acceptable, you know, to talk about the environment. We have so many other problems. You know, when you look at the SDG list as well in India, probably the top priority would be food, poverty, healthcare, these kind of things, right? Access. So environment is not something that comes to your mind immediately. So it's very difficult to be an environmental entrepreneur in India. Then on top of that, you know, social enterprise is not something that's so acceptable. So people don't understand why you want to make a profit or why you need to be paid sometimes. And that's very hard to explain, because we also still need to pay salaries, right? Like, it's just because it's profit, it doesn't mean that it's bad or it's a polluted word. So it's very hard to explain this in-between space. We've been very fortunate. We've had some great international partners who recognized our potential very early on, and who've implemented our products in these international projects. So it's been really good. Like, a lot of people ask us as well why we don't do more work in India. And that's exactly my answer. The unfortunate thing is that even though the government may be willing, it's very difficult, because for them, the top priority is infrastructure. Their top priority is, you know, like, if you're talking about sanitation, their first priority was to create a bathroom. They're not even thinking about behavior change at that point, because first step is, you don't have the bathroom, what will you do behavior change and do? So our problems are very different, unfortunately. So even though they have the probably the willingness to pursue something, it's not the right time. We're very early in India for the Indian market. We're very early as a company. And also the diversity problem in India is so big that even if we do pursue a market in India, the amount of translation that would be required, because literally every 40 or 50 kilometers, like, the language is changing, you know, the dialects are changing, the context is changing, because a student who lives by the coast will not understand biodiversity issues in the hills and vice versa, right? So if we were to make a game on biodiversity, it's very hard to explain to even a student in Delhi who is 5 years old what the sea looks like and what are the problems associated with it. So these challenges, because of the diversity, it's very difficult to pursue a market in India. Internationally, that's why we work with smaller countries like Kuwait, Singapore, that have very similar, very homogeneous kind of education system, clouds, where what they're teaching, how they're teaching, the language that they're teaching is pretty homogeneous. So that's kind of what we've been trying to target, but it's still impacting millions even through that one country. And that way we can kind of scale up our impact. Eventually, the hope is that India will be ready for something like this and we'll be able to scale in India. But of course, in India as well, we've got a lot of support from, like, individual mothers, from schools, some of the schools that have been very excited about this kind of product. So the journey has been bittersweet, I would say. There's a lot of struggle. It's not easy. Like, it's definitely not as easy as people think it is. a lot of people just become entrepreneurs overnight and think, oh great, we'll raise some money and like then we'll get a Series A, Series B, Series C and we'll be fine. But it doesn't work like that. It's a lot of hard work. You never switch off. Even when you're on vacation, you can't just switch off. You're always thinking about your business. You always have to be available for firefighting. So it's very tough. But it's also very fulfilling, like especially the kind of line that I am in, I feel like really fulfilled because at the end of the day, you feel like you're making a positive impact and you're doing something that's good. So it's not just about earning money, but you're doing something that's also creating a legacy for you to leave behind.
And what has been your major failure in this journey? What did you learn from that? Like, no, not a kind of very deep failure, something like, if you had, please do speak about it. Otherwise, we can just move on to giving advice to anybody who wants to become an entrepreneur.
Sure. So there have been so many failures because our product was so different, right? Like, how do you sell this product? It was so hard for us to get product market fit because when we started with activity boxes, but we only wanted to do environment-themed activity boxes. We only wanted to do environment-themed board games, which is a very small niche. One parent, how many environment board games will he or she buy? Right? They'll buy 2, 3 at best. If they're a hardcore environmentalist, 5. Plus, as an environmental, like if you're making a product, how many products will I make? I can never make 500 products or 500 different types of SKUs on environment. It's very superficial. Like if I'm doing that, then I'm you know, being really superficial about the problem. So I could not compete in the toy space because in the toy space, all of the big competitors who make board games, who make puzzles, they have thousands of SKUs. So they are coming to the market on Amazon, they'll have like 1,000 listings. In the shop, they'll have 1,000 products. So automatically the shelf space is more, visibility is more, all of that. I came to the market with 5 products. You know, it's just, there's no comparison. Plus, there were so many other challenges, like physical distribution is still really big in India. In India, people still buy, especially toys and stuff from their local shop. So when you do that, they expect you to cover it in plastic. That's something that was a complete no-no for us because we were an environmental education company, right? There's no way we were going to use plastic in our product. Without that, they don't accept your product. So you basically can't get into any store in India. Like you can't get into Crosswords, you can't get into Hamleys because you refuse to like put a plastic wrap on it, right? So it's very challenging to get that balance because how do I stay true to my values while also wanting to make a profit? Like how do I get that product market fit? So we tried so many things. We tried physical distribution, we tried online. We tried doing workshops with schools. So we would do lots and lots of workshops. It's so challenging. That whole thing kind of failed and collapsed because schools are also, they have to work really hard to manage all the different stakeholders. They have to make sure it's exciting for the child. They also have to answer to parents. They also have to make sure that the teacher's toes are not stepped on because the teacher works really hard on lesson plans and stuff. The boards. So how do they manage that? And it's very difficult for them. So they'll take up the workshop the one time, they'll love it. And then they won't go back and call you because like maybe one teacher didn't like it or like one teacher thinks that the environmental education teacher is not happy with the way this was conducted, you know. So there's a lot of challenges that we faced with this entire thing. And that's when we finally found this product market fit of selling to these large organizations. It worked for us to a certain extent, but of course it's really challenging because when you're working with governments, nothing gets done in 15 days, 20 days. It's not like an online sale where I just made an impulse purchase and I bought the product. Government cycles are 2 years sometimes and there's every single detail, every word has to be approved. Every color, every design has to be approved, you know. So it's like very, very challenging to deal with that long sales cycle, to deal without cash flows for that much time. So, you know, these are some of the challenges that we face even after finding product market fit. And because our sales cycles are long, because we have governments as clients, although it's big money, no investor would invest in you because unless we have an alternate revenue stream, which is more predictable. Like if you were an e-commerce company, easy. Because it's more predictable. You know, this is your rate. Every month I'm getting 5 lakhs, 10 lakhs, whatever it is. With the government, maybe you'll get 3 CR. But you don't know if it's going to take 12 months, 16 months, 18 months or 24 months, right? So the investors are also skeptical. We also don't want to go out and raise investing because we don't want an investor to come in and say, hey, Hamleys is ready to take you on. please put plastic wrap on your product and sell it. You know, there's definitely going to be a value mismatch. It's very hard to find an investor who has the same values as you, and it's not easy to uncover in, you know, before you actually start working with that person on a regular basis. So there's a lot of challenges. We've been very lucky, I must say, to find very good sales partners and partners in general abroad who really believe in the product and who push it like it's their own company, like it's amazing. So that way, it's very heartening to see that a product is good enough that other people care about it so deeply. But yeah, it's not an easy journey for sure.
And what's the reason you think that people are not able to accept the plastic? Like, why do they require plastic? Is it the problem of a different market or a different place? Or is it the mindset? Like, what's the problem you think that...
It's both. I think it's a little bit of both. One is a parent doesn't think it's a new product unless it's wrapped in plastic. They're so used to seeing a new product wrapped in plastic. Even a box of mushrooms. If you go out and buy mushrooms today, you would not just buy mushrooms like... It's very rare. In cities especially, we see that it comes in a plastic box, in a plastic bag. Wo seal chahe chitni baar khol do aap. But plastic mein aayega to theek hai. So that is just one is the mindset, especially with toys, with children's products. They want to see that it's unused because a lot of them are using it for gifting. So they want it to feel packed. Second, more realistic challenge is that parents go to shops. Not every time a salesperson will be with the parent. Very often parents or whoever's buying, not just parents, will open the box, try to see what's in it, trying to see, you know, those kind of things, in which case the product gets damaged. I can't sell the product. Right? So if it's sealed with plastic, then the shop owner doesn't have to worry. You know, they know immediately if the plastic is damaged that this product has been tampered with. And normally a person, like even you would think twice before you try to tear a plastic. If a product is already open, you would check. You would try to see what's going on. But if a product is sealed, you would not so easily break open the seal, you know. So that is the more realistic challenge for them. They also don't want the product to get damaged because then they have to pay. Agar uspe dhool lag gayi ya fungus lag gaya. So then that's their liability. Right. So all of these are the real on-ground challenges. So I don't blame them because obviously they don't care about your business the way you care about your business. So they are not going to take any extra effort. They are just there to provide a platform. So we, for us, it was a value challenge, but yeah, this was the on ground reality for this.
I'm sorry. So why don't you think, did you try to find an alternative for plastic? Like, did you try to, you know, find something else so that, something can be done or something?
Yeah. So way back when I had my first company, Upcycle Co. That time we actually fought. I remember we fought with one of the bigger e-commerce names. I can't remember which one. And we had actually had a fight because they listed my product under plastic. And my product was made from recycled plastic. And I said, there's a very big difference because when you say plastic, it can mean virgin plastic. And then the whole purpose of my business is lost. So I'd actually fought with them. And they had created a separate category for me, product subcategory for me called recycled plastic, in which I was the only product at that time.
Okay.
So, because I had fought for 3 months for it. And even after that, at that time, they were very like, they would not take my product. I've had courier guys like in front of me, like they've taken my product next day, they've come back and it's like stamped, it's torn apart, it's opened up, my products inside has gone missing, it's like in a very bad condition. No way that has happened under normal circumstances. I know the courier guy has told me this, has done it himself, because he's told me that I told you to use plastic, you didn't use plastic, this is what happens when you don't use
plastic. Okay.
And that plastic is not some like some wow like casing or something around it, it's a bag. So there was no way that it could not have happened if I was using plastic. It would have still happened. You know, the same way. Yeah. But it's just that they are like, I'm telling you to use it, you have to use it. You know, so I face these challenges all the time, mm-hmm. especially in e-commerce. So in e-commerce now, we've started, like, obviously now with the plastic ban and stuff in Maharashtra and in general in the country with the conversation about plastic getting stronger, more and more people, like even courier companies are way more open to using paper-based packaging. So we created custom boxes with inserts that were corrugated so that everything fits perfectly and nothing moves. Basically, if nothing moves and the box outside is sturdy, it doesn't break. So we use those and we directly put our shipping label on top. So the corrugation is made at an FSC certified factory. It's 100% recycled. It's made very, very well. So that is basically how we combated the problem. A lot of people came to us and said, why don't you use bioplastics? Like, you know, if you want to get into physical distribution, just put bioplastic on top. Bioplastics doesn't have enough research done on them. Everyone thinks, okay, just because it's written compostable, it must be compostable. That's not the case. If you put it in a home composter and you actually test it out, you'll see a lot of the plastics don't compost. Okay. And that means that if you discard it and you just throw it on the pavement, of course it's not going to compost. In any case, if you just throw it on the pavement, which is where it lands up most of the time, because your rag picker or the guy who's picking up your kachra doesn't know if this is a regular plastic or a bioplastic. There's no fifth bin for that, right? Like, extra bin for bioplastic dalo. So he's going to mix it up and he's going to put it. So neither can it be recycled, neither can it be composted effectively. And if you just throw it out on your pavement, though, for sure it's not composting because there's no soil left for it to compost in. So I can't control the end of life of that. I cannot control each customer who buys from me. I cannot control what that customer is doing with their plastic. Yeah. So it's easier for me to do something like a corrugated box, which I know for a fact that every raddiwala will take because it's paper and it's well made and paper has value in this country. Everyone stocks their newspaper to give to the raddiwala or kuch rakhe na rakhe. So paper and board and boxes and all, people keep for reuse. People keep sell it to the raddiwalas for recycling. वो सब होता है, so that's why we stuck to paper-based.
Okay. And so what would be your advice to anybody who wants to start up their own environment, like a green company? What would be your advice?
My advice, oh God, I don't think I'm in a position to give advice yet. But my advice would be definitely think 3 times, 4 times, 10 times before you want to get into the space. Only if you feel very passionately about it, get into it. A lot of people nowadays are just getting into it because they think they can make a quick buck. But please don't do that.
Yeah.
Please don't do that. One, you will not make a quick buck. Mm-hmm. Two, if you are just selling a product that you genuinely don't know if it's good for the environment or not, don't sell it because you're just causing more harm.
Yeah.
Right? So don't just jump on this bandwagon ki plastic ban ho gaya, toh let me like suddenly go crazy selling like, you know, like a compostable plastic bin line, right? Because you don't know for sure like whether that's good for the environment or not. So at least if you're not doing any good, don't do any harm. And definitely run your numbers beforehand. Like find a market, especially if you want to run your business in India. Find something that's easily acceptable for the Indian customer to buy and make it, because we're a very value-driven economy, we're a very value-driven audience. We care a lot about inexpensive pricing. You have to try and sell them a product that can be used maybe again and again, someone who will buy it every month, and something that's, you know, that's valuable for them. So it's like at a good enough price point that the Indian customer will buy it very easily. And there's a lot of ways to do that. It's not just plastics and it's not just that, right? Like it's not just organic, it's not just bamboo. There's a lot of ways in which you can create an environmentally friendly product. It could be a better made product that consumes less energy. So it could be anything, a pair of headphones that is more durable, like average life of a headphone, if it's 5 years and your headphones can be used for 20 years, that's still a more environmentally friendly product. So, you know, don't think about like reinventing the wheel and going crazy. Make something that's sensible and that's actually impactful to the planet and something that the Indian customer will see value in if you want to run a business in India.
Okay, yeah, wonderful. So last quick question, what have been the difficult phases of, you know, being, you know, we like now the lockdown is opening. So from past, we have been in lockdown from past 2 months. So how is your business affected? And not only about the negative part, what are the optimistic things that happened? Like what are the positive things? What are the, what did you learn from this phase of, you know, the lockdown which we are in?
Oh yeah, I think negative things to a lot of people will tell you because it's been bad. I mean, sales waves have really taken a back seat. All of your business planning has gone for a toss. But positives, I think it's really good for entrepreneurs at least, because I think it really has given you the time to take a step back and reevaluate your strategy, to re-explore, you know, the creative side of things, especially for creative entrepreneurs who the main reason why they liked the business was because they like to be creative, right? So it's given you that time to really explore those things. So like a lot of entrepreneurs I know would get in because, for example, they really like sketching or art, right? And they created an art-based business. But over time, what happens is that you are constantly firefighting issues. You're constantly so like focused on अच्छा GST का filing करना है, accounts करना है, ये करना है, वो करना है, that you don't have the time to actually do what you care about in that business. So the lockdown really has allowed people to get that extra time to not be firefighting constantly and instead like take a step back and one, re-strategize, so create a strategy that works for the business long term and allows for durability of the business so that when a situation like this arises next time, your business doesn't like succumb to it. And two, to really explore that creative aspect of the business and to develop new things. Like I ended up developing 3 new products during this lockdown period, right? And it was a great like time of creativity for my team as well as us, because for me as well, because it's been, we've suddenly had this time to just think about the product and nothing else. Because not much else was going on. So I think those are definitely the positive outcomes.
Okay, so yeah, wonderful. Thank you very much for, you know, giving us a brief out about your company, about how you became, like how you started a sustainable, eco-friendly company. Yeah, thank you very much. It was a pleasure to have you. Thank you.
It was a pleasure speaking to you as well, Lakshya. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.